I would like to be able to say that the research around education technology is glowing, that everything we're doing with technology is showing these amazing positive results when it comes to student learning. Unfortunately, that's not necessarily the case. It's a bit murky. What we've had to do is dig a little bit deeper. What we found is that those gains are often coming not necessarily from a ubiquitous use of technology, but rather a very purposeful and careful use of technology. And getting even deeper into it, we're seeing that the instructional practices of the teacher make the largest difference.
The ed tech plan says that students really need to know how to use technology to solve real life problems. We're beginning to see that shift where we're actually using technology as a tool to transform learning, more to help students become creative thinkers, critical problem solvers, collaborators, and working differently with technology rather than just using technology to do what we've always done.
Kids are doing so much more advanced things now than I ever imagined could even be possible as a high school student. Our kids think, they interact with each other, they build team skills, they create products out of information they find, and all of that really goes back to happening because they have an easy access or avenue to do that, and technology plays a large role in that.
So today in my classroom, you would have seen students who are starting a personalized writing unit. What I do is I go on to Google Sites, and it allows me to create content that can be differentiated for everybody in my classroom. It doesn't matter what level you're at. So if you're at a basic level, you can still work independently with me circulating. And then as I'm circulating, I'm noticing these kids are lacking in this area or these kids are really strong in this area. So I have a couple opportunities to either partner kids who are strong with kids who need some support, or I can pull three or four kids into a group, focus on that skill. The next day, I can pull a different small group and focus on a new skill. So it just allows me to personalize and differentiate much more readily.
One area that I think has been extremely beneficial when it comes to digital technologies in school has been for assistive technologies. So technology can help all students, but in particular our students with particular needs.
Braden has the diagnosis of cerebral palsy. Today he was in a science class. They had a presentation to do on a national park. Braden was in a small group with his Chromebook, and so using Read and Write Google, he's able to talk his answers to the computer today for the presentation and hand that in and interact with a class more and be more involved. I think for so long for him in school, people have just assumed that the physical work that he's doing is his ability. You know, and now he can use these tools and show all this stuff and have independence. I think that's the biggest thing.
I think our staff is making the transition from being something where students are receiving knowledge and the teacher is a font of wisdom. The teacher can really become really an aid in helping that student reach a potential.
Pretty much every single student in our school district has their own computer. That's changed dramatically. Every single student, whether they're special needs, not special needs, every student has a Chromebook.
You know, I think more than anything else, technology has just become ubiquitous, right? It's kind of like the air we breathe in our schools. And we're not about technology here. I think that's the interesting thing about this is I would not call our one-to-one initiative a technology initiative. It's a learning initiative. You know, what we want to do is create the very best learning experiences for kids that we possibly can, period.
At Council Bluffs, everyone's on board to make sure that, you know, everyone has the tools that they need in order to learn. It levels the playing field. And, you know, kids are able to do things now that, you know, they were never able to do before.
For an initiative like this to be successful, you have to understand this idea that things are possible now that weren't possible before. You know, when I'm thinking through how are kids going to demonstrate their understanding of a concept, their understanding of some content, that there are lots and lots of ways that I can have kids show that now. It doesn't have to be in a written essay. right? I can have kids create using any of the technologies that they have at their disposal. They can create videos and they can create audio and they can use images and annotate those images. They can also write. They can write all kinds of different kinds of text.
We want students to be able to take charge of their learning, to be able to know how to learn and how to demonstrate competencies through learning.
In our case, we start with why. We have created some very clearly defined why statements around why we do all of this, why we're making the investment of time and energy and significant money into this technology-rich environment.
I can try to use different words when I'm leaving. Let's watch.
In terms of Milo, he has a very specific purpose, and that purpose is to assist special education students on the autism spectrum with appropriate communication and recognizing nonverbal skills. For some students, having a relationship with that device is easier than having a relationship with a human being.
Great job.
And for this very special group of students, they're learning social skills that they will use with other human beings from a device, from this robot. I find it to be amazing.
Mix it up, you know.
Students are learning these social clues and cues and appropriate responses from the technology, from the robot, and applying them in their daily life with people.
For most students that work with Milo, it's so intuitive for them. When Milo asks for their attention, eyes on Milo, students engage. And then when they engage, their attention is there. The cadence of the speech is slower, allowing more time to process. That keeps anxiety lower. So there's just more retention. There's a greater processing through it. It's just, again, another opportunity for a student to be very individually engaged and realize those greatest potentials.
Gotta go. Bye.
To see the true application with a student who needs to develop particular kinds of skills, to watch it, you know, happen was amazing for me. It's why you do the work.